Welcome to this video in the video series on our successful future. In this video, I would like to say something about the currently published, so currently when I record this video, EU sustainable energy strategies, which have been published end of November in 2018. If we look at the scenarios that are evaluated and those that work to reach the corresponding climate goals of 1.5 degrees centigrade climate change with respect to pre-industrial level, we get such a picture. So this is the CO2 emissions that we want to reach as a function of time for different, well, industrial areas, more or less. What we see is actually that if we look at the CO2 emissions, that between 2005 and 2010, there was a certain decrease. That slowed apparently down in the 5 years after that, so until 2015, which is of course negative. We slowed down our efforts, which is bad. One has to realize that quite clearly. And we slowly try to increase that and match this high slope that we had in the past only somewhere again around 2030. So we wait until we increase our efforts another more than 10 years. And that is, of course, highly detrimental for reaching the climate goals, because it means that on the other hand side, we have to get very steep here, which means we have to substitute fossil energy technologies at a very high rate later, because we start so late. The sooner we start here, so to speak, the lower can be the annual decrease that is required to really finally reach the decarbonization of our economy. That's one aspect. I will show that in more detail in the following slides. As a basis, I should also say that the EU scenarios assumes the world population development according to the medium variant of the 2015 version of the World Population Prospect of the United Nations. As I show in the video on world population, it's actually to be assumed that world population will develop according to the high variant. It's not unlikely that that happens. So that needs to be considered as a realistic option as well, at least that. And that means, in turn, of course, if that should occur, that the land area that we need to feed everybody will be higher as compared to the medium variant, which means, in turn, that the land area available, for example, for bioenergy will be significantly less if we want to feed everybody. Actually, if in the high variant we don't have any land area for bioenergy additionally, or significant additional bioenergy available. The EU assumptions actually assume that the bioenergy will need to increase by 80%, which means that's possibly possible with the medium variant, but if you develop like that, that does not work out. It would be unethical because there are 800 million people currently starving, and deploying more bioenergy technology means more people starving, which is actually not really acceptable. So in turn, this means that together with the energy scenarios, one also has to consider, of course, population growth, which means if we want to reach this medium variant, we have to significantly increase our efforts for developing less developed regions, because only that decreases population growth. Only that will allow to get from this variant to that variant, or possibly lower. So it's not just about energy, it's also about developing, looking at the entire system. What I show here now is the substitution rate as a function of time. In the past, substitution rate meaning how much primary energy supply is substituted by additional solar and wind energy in 1 year. So how much of our bad technologies I substitute by solar and wind in 1 year. These are the world values, and these are the EU values shown in blue. There's a large scatter, so I take the 3 year averages as lines, and you see here these lines, they are behaving more or less not so stochastically jumping. For the EU, we nevertheless realize that during the last many years, actually our efforts have decreased, so the substitution rate is more or less constant at somewhere around 0.5% that we substitute additionally every year. If we continue to it at that rate, we need something of the order of 200 years, so 100% divided, well, it's actually only 85% left, divided by the 0.5%, that's 170 years until we manage the decarbonization. World system is less with a substitution rate, but it's making up quite quickly. So it will be overtaking us quite soon if we don't really significantly increase. That's one thing. On the other hand side, we can look at the anti-energy system. So this is the primary energy consumption that we have as a function of time for the EU. We see that hydrogen energy had always a certain contribution. Nice, it changed a little bit over time, increased overall a little bit. And this actually, this small range in between here that develops over the last years, that's what we actually, that depicts, so to speak, how much effort we put into renewable energies. Solar and wind are this red and this light blue areas here. And that's actually the part that we need to grow further, because only that has a capacity to supply sufficient energy for everybody. On the other hand side, we see that this is still what is remaining to be substituted with respect to fossil and nuclear energy. And if you look at the time scale, so this are 1965 to 2015, so many, many decades. And actually, if you want to reach the 1.5 climate degree centigrade climate goal, we need to finish our transition by 2050, that is 32 years. Yeah, so significantly less than that, we have to somehow grow that up quite quickly. Okay, how fast does that have to happen? Simple arithmetics. So this is around 15%, so we have to make up for another 85%. But actually, we can possibly assume that this trend of the past decade, more or less, may continue, decrease, so that possibly instead of the 85% of today's values, only 65% are required because they decreased to a certain degree. Neglecting that during the last 2 years, it increased again, actually. So actually, that's detrimental. If I assume it continues like that, saving energy is progressing, then it's only 65%. Now, and as I said, until 2050, it's 32 years. So 65% that we have to substitute divided by 32 years is simply 2% per year. So we can compare that to where we are at the moment, and this is now shown in this diagram that we saw partially already previously. This is now the 2%, and where we are at the moment at somewhere around 0.4, 0.6%. So it's jumping between such values. On the other hand side, the world at the moment is at around 0.4%. In this three-year average, the last value is around 0.5%. So we see that actually we slow down, but we need to get there. And that this is actually the strategy that is proposed, that we increase that, so to speak, according to the step function, only the steps, because it's not really a smooth function shown in the diagram. So something like that. So we actually quite slowly increase our efforts. Since it's so slow, so here we are emitting too much CO2, we have to speed up, as I mentioned previously already, we have to speed up afterwards even further, so we have to exceed even the 3% substitution rate at some point in time. 3% is a lot. So we have to supply sufficient photovoltaics equipment, sufficient wind turbines, so as to substitute more than 3% of our primary energy consumption in 1 year. And this is quite excessive. I actually think that there's a more or less realistic limit around 3%. So this is really almost too high. So what we actually should do, we should speed up here a little bit faster so that we avoid our slow progress in the beginning, and then only are required to reach a lower, highest goal, so to speak. At the end, it has to drop a little bit, because substituting the last percent will be very difficult, because there are special applications, things like that. There to realize a decarbonization will be increasingly difficult, so that drops a little bit is realistic. I didn't account that in my scenarios, but that is, of course, realistic. On the other hand side, the additional CO2 emitted during these last few years is actually not so much, so that shifts the reached climate change not so dramatically. So the big things have to happen here. The faster we start, the lower we can get here in the intermediate time. On the other hand side, of course, we see the world, on the other hand side, I worked that out, has to reach 3% average substitution rate for extended periods of time. Why is that higher? Well, simply because for the world, the primary energy consumption is continually increasing because there are continually more people, and the per capita consumption is increasing. For the EU, we saw the overall demand is slightly decreasing over the decade, and that's the big difference. So we have to substitute more and more every year on the world scale, and that's, since the substitution rate is always with respect to the individual year, that is has to get higher to cover up the overall amount in the end. So there we need to go to the 3%, starting from the somewhere around 0.5% today. So we need from this average value, so to speak, we need almost a factor of 10 for the world and around 5 for the EU. Both world and EU have to increase their efforts significantly, increase their installation rate of solar and wind energy quite dramatically. And the EU should start as soon as possible, because these high values in between, we will hardly be able to realize that actually. Okay, so we can conclude. For the world population, also the EU, like the IPCC, assume a presumably too low population growth, which means actually the second point, bioenergy cannot be applied as strongly as proposed if we want to be ethical with respect to world hunger. On the other hand side, since we wait so long according to the EU scenarios, and that we need to go too high substitution rates at some intermediate time in the future, which is of course nice, it's so far away that the politicians today don't need to bother about that. So actually we should start increasing the efforts today. And that's why actually it's too optimistic, the picture that is drawn, because these high values, it's questionable if that can really be reached. It's more and more difficult. The lower we remain, the better it is. So we should get fast as soon as possible, because that lowers the overall value that needs to be reached. In turn, this means we need significant instantaneous increase in effort in Europe, and that is quite essential. With that, I would like to say thank you for watching this video, and I hope I can see you in one of the other videos as well.